Also jetzt bin ich doch im Englischen. Ja, und wir haben Tom eingeladen, um ja, mySociety.org als Organisation vorzustellen, um verschiedenste Projekte vorzustellen, weil wir glauben, dass wir in Deutschland noch viel von ihren Ideen und viel von ihrem Engagement lernen können. Sie bauen oder haben schon eine ganze Menge kleinere Plattformen gebaut, die sehr einfach technisch gelöst sind, aber die ja, kleine und große Probleme einfach lösen. Und die wird er vorstellen. Und ja, wenn ihr sie interessant findet und wenn ihr programmieren könnt, wir brauchen in Deutschland auch mal so ähnliche Projekte. Sie sind meistens nicht besonders schwer und ich hoffe, dass die, ja, dass der Talk jetzt ein bisschen Inspiration gibt, sowas hier auch zu entwickeln. Dann mal einen kleinen Applaus für Tom.
Hello, so my name is Tom Steinberg. I'm the director of mySociety, and what mySociety is these people here. We're about two-thirds, three-quarter volunteer group, and put together we run most of what you might call the democracy websites in the UK. I kind of show you this picture because it's a kind of a better summation than words can of the sort of people that mySociety is and the sort of kind of non-corporate open source background that we all have. So back in the year 2000, some volunteers, of whom one or two were on that photo, built a website called faxyourmp.com, F-A-X. And what it did is you put in a postcode into a box, and it told you who your MP was, your Member of Parliament, that is, and then let you send them a message, which in most cases was sent over the internet but via a fax machine. Website, fax machine goes to MP's fax machine. And that was because most MPs didn't use email in those days. To give an example of what mySociety does, it's hard to beat what fax your MP was and what it became. And what it became is this, which is writetothem.com. If we take a British postcode here, and we put it in the box, assuming that you're not all busy downloading things from the Pirate Bay, making the connection work really badly, then you will see that this shows you who all your different kinds of politicians are. So that postcode is a postcode in London, and people in London have both local councillors on the left, they have London Assembly members, they have a Member of Parliament, they have various members of the European Parliament. And through this website, you can write to any of them. It's a service that is for the user, because everything we do is very much about making a simple but really tangible benefit for the user, something they can really understand. Like, I go to Amazon, I get a book, I go to Google, I get a search result. And often you go to mySociety sites and you get something similarly tangible. You get your message sent to your politician in this case. But we survey everybody who sends a message to their politician gets mailed a couple of weeks later. And because they get mailed, we're able to produce league tables. These league tables are all based off the survey question, which says, did you hear back from your politician? That's all. We just want to know whether or not they got an answer. And as a consequence of these people filling in the survey, and many, many of them do, we produce these statistics on who is good and who is bad at writing back to their own constituents. Now, I show you this not only because I think this is quite both a fun thing and a useful thing, but because, again, it's a general lesson that you can learn if you're thinking about building kind of political sites of your own, is how can we build something which is all about me, I want a problem fixed, but which generates information that is valuable for everybody else. And this, in some ways, is the kind of classic example here. If you click through on one of these links here, you will get to a website called theyworkforyou.com. Now, so theyworkforyou is a version of everything that is said in Parliament, and lots of information brought together around what is said, all the debates and all the votes, that looks like this. This is a page on an MP. This is where I live. This MP represents me. It's a very controversial MP in Britain. You can see that this page brings together masses of information and services about this one MP. I'll see if I can make it a little bit bigger so you can read it. There we are. So you can see that, as well as having a suspicious moustache, he changed party. So he was elected for one party, but then he set up his own. You can send him messages through the other services. But we can also see all this information here about how he voted. Now, things like voted strongly against introducing ID cards and voted moderately against Labour's anti-terrorism laws. These look like these are written by people. These look like this is something that a journalist has sat down and typed out. But actually, they're not. These are algorithms that look at a whole set of votes, maybe 10 or 20 votes, and they work out if an MP was 100% for the Iraq war, if they voted 100% for the Iraq war in every vote, how would they have voted? And the answer is often they would have voted in 10 votes, and they would have said yes, yes, no, yes, no, no, yes, no. And that would mean they were for it. Then it compares that example. It compares the archetypal 100% pro-war MP against all the MPs. And so you end up with these statements, which are then turned into plain English. This page contains loads of information like this. It contains the things that he asked questions about, the most recent times that he spoke in Parliament, and what he said when he spoke in Parliament. And then, of most interest to many people, are all these statistics. He spoke in 4 debates in the last year, and that's well below average amongst MPs. Basically, he never shows up because he's too busy being on television. He voted in 10% of votes in Parliament, which is well below average as well. But very interestingly, you'll notice it says, replied within two or three weeks to a low number of messages sent via right to them. So what you have there is you have one of the websites that people are using to write to their politicians produces statistics that then powers the other website. It creates public knowledge, and that tells us something useful about George Galloway, which is that for all his virtues as a public speaker, he's not really very dedicated to his constituents. These pages are really popular, and as a consequence of being really popular, they are very high within the Google rankings. This whole website is roughly as popular as any of the most popular political blogs in the UK. So even though it doesn't have day-to-day sort of news and scandal and gossip, it remains a very, very popular resource and a thing very much worth, I think, learning from and copying. For an interesting story about how this sort of thing affects politicians in the modern world, we had a politician who got in touch with us and said, my rating that about how good I am at writing back to my constituents, he goes, that must be wrong because we're really good at this. And we wrote and we looked at all the statistics and we wrote back and we said, it doesn't look to us like there's anything wrong with your statistics, yet your rating is really low. So you might want to go and ask all the people who work in your office. You might want to go and say, you might want to go and check to make sure if it's really as good as they all say it is. See if it's all working and all the letters are being responded to. And he wrote back a few days later, and he just wrote one line. He said, yeah, turns out I was talking shite. That was his response. And what it meant is that he'd found out because of these statistics that his own team weren't as good at responding to mail as they'd told him he was, told him they were. And as a consequence, he's almost certainly gone and improved things. So this sort of stuff is more than just of theoretical interest. We know that politicians, as well as members of the public, pay attention to the sort of things that appear on this site. Another thing I particularly like that I only just discovered before in the workshop is that on this guy's overseas visits, this is where he gets free gifts and free travel, 16th of January 2008 to the Cayman Islands, you know where the Cayman Islands are, as a guest of the Cayman Islands Celtic Supporters Club. Now Celtic is a football team in Scotland, but they have a supporters club in the Cayman Islands, and they've chosen to fly him out. Nothing dubious about that, I'm sure. So that's one branch of what we do, is very political stuff. But we think that democratic websites go broader than just looking at politicians, writing to politicians, discussing things with politicians. We think that they embrace the universe of how communities work, how stuff gets fixed, how people resolve their problems, how people basically take power and take control in their own lives. And so here's a really good example of that. This is Fix My Street. You can probably see here that My Society has a design aesthetic which is very simple. We always go for things being extremely usable, very unfussy, normally with a homepage with just one box and one thing to do. And that is part of our goal, to make not just our site usable, but make them usable in particular to the sort of people who are least politically engaged, the people who are the very opposite internet users to people who maybe write a political blog that they update every day. Political bloggers use our site a great deal, and it's really good that they do, but actually our main audience is first timers, people who've never done anything like this before, people who've never written to a politician before, people who've never reported a problem in their street. What happens here is people basically type in a postcode again, go here, and assuming again that the internet connection isn't full of porn, we will find that we get a map loading slowly, and we can stick a pin in the map, and now we can type what the problem is, where that pin is, and the problem will get, the computer will work out which one of the 470 local governments in the UK is this problem the responsibility of. Where is it? It's inside a certain boundary, and that means it's in Tower Hamlets Borough Council, it says on the left there. You type your message, you press go, it gets sent off to the council. Now, there's a couple of things that are different about this. This looks like something that you might possibly have on your government website anyway, but it's not, because we're about democracy as an organization. What's different is that these problems all become public. And here's a particularly amusing one that is lurking here on the front page. Somebody has decided that the world needs to see not just a report about the fact that their neighbor is letting their dog shit on the lawn, but actually a photo as well. So we have excellent documentary evidence and a big pin in the map showing exactly where this crime has happened. And you can see if you look down here that anyone can come along and leave an update. So somebody else has left a little update here, and we could go along, we could leave an update. So what this does is this makes reports that would previously be in private, it makes them part of the public realm. And we heard a story, for example, of somebody saying, I tried to get something fixed for a while, the council ignored it, but then when I put it on Fix My Street, the council responded to it just because it was public, and they knew that they couldn't sort of hide it anymore. They knew it had a degree of public availability and visibility. And because we like things to be visible publicly, we build big APIs, big different ways that you can get this information, and you can put it on other sites. So you can get email alerts for every new problem with a certain area, or email alerts within a certain council, or within a certain ward, which is a very small area of government, maybe with just a couple of thousand people living in a little area. You can get RSS feeds for all of these. And so what we're starting to see is people adding RSS feeds to the side of local blogs. People who write local blogs about one area will have a list that says, here's the three most recent things and problems going on. And that sort of follows our general idea that this site is about fixing my problem really easily, but about hooking me into the community a little bit at the same time and generating public value by telling everyone else what is going on and connecting people together a little bit. Probably the most substantial example of this that we've done recently is Groups Near You. So Groups Near You is all about the myriad of email lists, discussion forums, Facebook groups, any number of different online communications platforms that exist in little local areas around the world. Local areas where they might cover just one apartment block, they might cover just a street, a small part of town. The problem with these things at the moment is that they exist, but they don't really exist on the web. It's not necessarily very easy to find these things. They're in 10,000 different platforms. And Groups Near You is simply about putting all of them on the map, regardless of what platform they're on. It doesn't care whether it's in Google Groups or Yahoo Groups. It just gives it a place on a map and allows people to share that. So let me give you an example here. I'm just going to skip forward here. This is what happens if you use the API in London. We'll just zoom out a little bit. What we've got here is a whole load of blue boxes of all different sizes, and these blue boxes represent all these different groups that people have made. You can see them on the left-hand side a little bit. So Barbican Talk. The Barbican is a set of apartment blocks in an expensive part of London. They just have a discussion forum for just them. The Bloomsbury Association. Bloomsbury is a part of London. These are all just indications of where you can find a map. That obviously needs tidying up there. This is back to groups near you, the raw website itself. You can see it covers this little part of town. Now, why might you want to do this? You might want to add your group, basically in the hope that more people who move to an area will find it, will join it. At the moment, almost the only way you would ever have to know that there was such a group in your area is probably if you met your neighbors or they knocked on your door and said, would you like to join our email list? By making this site and then giving all the information in it out for free, we hope that we can encourage people who run other websites that have local components to bring these groups in. So the classic example would be, you could go to Fix My Street, you could report a problem on Fix My Street, and then it could say, you've reported your problem. Did you know that there is actually a residents association email list that covers the area that you've put your problem in? You could go and join it. You could tell the people about this problem. You could work together on it. So this is part of a pattern that is the last thing I'm going to talk about, which mySociety always tries to do. We have sites that vary from extremely simple and self-interested to much deeper and more engaging. So if you want, you can go and dig into the votes of MPs and see how they dig in. You can file freedom of information requests on our new site under our freedom of information law that we have, the new law we have in Britain, where you can make a request and the government has to give you information. But we always expect that people will come to the simplest things and we will pass them on to the harder ones. And our vision is a little bit like this. In an era when increasingly few people are very politically engaged, at least in Britain, and people are increasingly cynical about politics generally, we want to give people services that fix a thing in their life, that solve something that they need to be solved, but in the process engages them with something a little bit deeper, a little bit more challenging, and engages them in the community and the world they live in. And the classic example of this would be somebody goes and they send a message on Right to Them. They send the message to the politician. And after they finish sending the message, it says, well done, that's brilliant. Would you like to sign up to get an email from They Work For You whenever your MP says anything in Parliament? And many, many people click yes on this. We have very high conversion rates, sometimes as high as 25-30% of people who use one service will go and use a slightly more challenging one. And in time, what we want to do is make it so that anyone who starts doing something very simple, anyone who reports some dog shit in their street, can eventually get passed through up a sliding scale of difficulty and challenge and involvement until maybe it says to them one day, maybe you'd like to become a councillor. Maybe you'd like to actually become a politician yourself rather than just report problems. And that really is, I think, probably one of the big challenges for us in the next few years is taking these different things I've got today and making those paths very, very clear so that an increasing number of people move from the very, very simple thing, I've got a problem, to a very, very hard thing, which is I want to campaign in my area, I want to meet my neighbors, we want to change things about the world we live in. And that, I think, in short, is what mySociety is all about. So thank you. I don't know if we actually have time for Q&A. Who's timekeeping here?
Yeah,
a little, okay.
5 minutes.
Hello, Tom. Thanks for your talk. I'm following your work for quite some time now. And what you just said, the very last sentences, reminded me a lot of the design of games. Like you have a very shallow start and you get into it deeper and deeper. And have you considered doing something like a game structure on top of the system you already have? Like collecting points or be awarded some additional things, something like this?
We haven't thought of a point system. We did within Fix My Street, though. For example, we did think of putting in a league table for the people using the site rather than the government responding, so that you could have sort of competition between people reporting more things. I think we've learned bits and pieces from the world of games, but not a lot. But you're quite right to pick up that kind of easy to harder thing. But then again, this shows the challenge, because I'm sure you've all played games. that where the first 2 hours is brilliant. It's like start easy and it gets harder and harder, and then suddenly it's ridiculously difficult and you stop because the curve is too hard. It's actually going to be quite a challenge for us to get it right. But it also, your question shows up a belief that we really have to attack, and that everybody who wants to build useful services in this field really, really does have to attack, which I can show very quickly in this. We run this. This is the petitions site for the Prime Minister in Britain. This is pretty much the only site we run for anybody else. People can go here, they can make petitions, they can sign petitions. You've got a similar thing for the Bundestag. This is really big. It's had like 7 million signatures on it. And I got asked by a politician in a committee question. He goes, well, when people sign this, he goes, it's not very profound, is it? It's not a very big political gesture. It's not very hard. He goes, what kind of political engagement do you call kind of putting a signature on this? And I said, it's low engagement. It's very low. And that's actually what makes it so great, because you can't get people from nothing to high engagement. You have to take people on a journey from like a little bit. And with 5 million people on here that the government can write back to and say, you know, here's our response, maybe you'd like to do something else. That's a very promising way of getting lots of low engaged people and taking them along. But you will find, if you ever spend any time in this field, that one of the most common accusations is that what you're doing is too easy, which if you program games, especially the first level of games, would just be insane. You're always looking for the first level of games to be so easy no one can fail. Anyone else? No, I think that's probably it. Well, thank you very much. Okay, hang on. We've got a kind of half follow-up. Maybe we should talk afterwards separately. Thank you very much indeed. All right.